Hello and welcome to The Collegium, our monthly magazine program in three parts: cinema, state of affairs, and our arts calendar. For our cinema presentation, we will present Holiday Interlude. For our state of affairs, we have our usual panelists, Dr. Temba Kadali and Charles Achie Odong. And for our special guest, we have Inspector Gadget, also known as Herman Purcell. Last but not least, our arts calendar with Expressions 1. Artists Marion Cromer, Vera Locompte, and Angela Cromer. So stay with us, and remember, you are participating in The Collegium.
And a special event, we are very pleased to be with Mr. Oscar Brown Jr. in all places, Berlin, Germany. Welcome to Berlin and the Collegium, Oscar.
Thank you, Donald Griffith. It's a long way from Chicago, huh?
Why are you here, Oscar?
Well, here it is. I put the advertisement right on my shirt. The Berlin Jazz Fest 98 brought me over to perform on the 7th at the, what did they call it, the Pregnant Oyster. Yes, and lovely auditorium, strange-looking building, but a very lovely auditorium.
And what did you do, Oscar, for those people who are not familiar with your artistry?
Well, I sang a whole bunch of songs, most of which I have written, well, all of which I had written in one way or another. Either I had collaborated with some jazz musicians like Bobby Timmons or Charlie Parker, who wrote the music to which I set lyrics, or other songs that I had composed entirely on my own.
Speaking about working with musicians, I've often heard it said that musicians and singers are not exactly the best combination in the world. They sort of have different directions or different perspectives. What has been your experience over these last 100 or so years?
I forget. It's been so long. Well, my experience has been that there are varied situations, you know. Some work very well. There have been musicians I've gone to work with and rehearsed one day, and we get on that night and really knock it out. There have been other situations, sort of like the one I was here in Berlin, where we rehearsed for several days, but the result wasn't executed. It wasn't a good execution, or it wasn't as good an execution as we had anticipated. So it varies. I've gotten to the point now where I like working with one musician. I like working with a pianist. Before he was killed, my son and I worked together. He was a bassist. And it gives another focus to the performance, because my songs are pretty much lyric driven, and if the people don't understand the story and don't understand the words, then I don't come off as well as I like.
Oscar, what is the source of your creativity?
You know, the great giver, you know. I am gifted, and that I kind of recognized when I was in college. I was 17 years old, and I was at the University of Wisconsin, and I flunked everything except English composition, in which I got an A+, because if they asked for a 100-word essay, I could write a 100-word poem, and I just dazzled my instructor. And as I say, that was the only real success I had in college, and that caused me to change my major from pre-law to an English major, with the determination that I would become a writer. That was when I was 17. It was probably 10 years or more before I really would say that I was a writer, because it took me that long to become the kind of writer that I wanted to be. and it's a rather a personal matter. I didn't just want to say it for show. I wanted to mean it. So the guy asked me one time, at that point, he said, what do you do? I said, I'm a writer. Oh, yeah, he said, how do you know you can write? I said, because I can read.
Oscar, when you create the songs or when you create the material that you do, is there ever a concern that the well might run dry? That the source of creativity or the ideas might not be there when you reach for them?
Well, I'm sure it's going to come as tomorrow. I mean, nothing's promised. Tomorrow isn't promised. But I have faith that it's coming, and I certainly have faith in my ability to write from day to day and from time to time. I don't write with the same sort of anxiety that I did. By that I mean anxiety to get my creativity out. I've done enough of it now to the point where I can sort of coast. I'm on cruise. But I am never desperate for inspiration. Because when it comes, I can deal with it. Whatever it happens to be, sometimes it'll be something funny, you know. Sometimes it'll be something quite serious. Sometimes it'll be just a phrase that occurs and sparks me to write. But the answer to your question is no, I'm never afraid the well is going to run dry.
In the creation of your material, the plays, the songs, the poetry, is your reading ever a source of inspiration or information? And if so, which authors and when?
Well, I'm not what you would call an avid reader. I would think that most of my inspiration tends to come from reading the I Ching, because I'm a devotee of that. And I cast the coins quite frequently at about all kinds of subjects with all kinds of questions. The I Ching being an oracular book that was started in China thousands of years ago, predates Confucius, who was a contributor, and has come down for all these centuries. It was translated by a German named Wilhelm, and that's the version of it that I first found. But now I have one, another version called The Changing Truth. It's over there by Niwa Ching, and I find that a very profound philosophy. It's based on Taoism, which isn't exactly a religion. That is, it's a lot of religions seem like man's attempt to make a deal with God. You know, it's like if I say so many Hail Marys, or if I say Nam Myoho Renge Kyo, or if I bow down and pray at a certain time, you're going to pay the rent, right? I mean, you're going to send me the money, I get the car, or the girl, or whatever. So I don't really have faith in that. Faith comes through revelation. And you see things and you have to recognize the truth in them and put them into your life. So the I Ching recommends that, and recommends that you work constantly on improving yourself. And if you do that, if you don't backtrack, you don't backslide, I mean, then you're gonna definitely make progress. And I guess you could call it serenity or confidence in the way things are going comes over you. The world is pretty much as it is. You just have to accept it. How do you fit into it? How can you deal with it?
When you talk about being gifted, what does that mean? Where does that source of inspiration or that structure come from that can permit one to be seen as or thought of as gifted? What does that mean?
There's a current school of thought, Donald, that suggests that everybody is gifted in one way or another. We all have aptitudes, talents, that we get from the talent giver. Remember, you can call it what you want. You can call it Allah, you can call it God, you can call it Buddha, you can call it anything you want to. But it's the same force, the same creative force that brought us into being. And there's only one being. That's the I am that I am, and there's no other. You can't divide those things. So I think it comes from that spiritual source. How it comes, I don't know. I say thanks a lot. you know, for letting me be the medium for what I do. But then you have, you know, the things that you do, your aptitudes and your gifts and your talent, in the same, with the same understanding that each of us has gifts. People now think that to measure intelligence by IQ, intelligence quotient, it's not how intelligent are you or how smart are you, but how are you smart? So to each of us, if we find the ways in which we are smart, if those things are recognized, appreciated, not just in the sense of being enjoyed, but as you would appreciate a piece of property by putting a house on it, by building on it, by expanding. If it's appreciated, if it's trained, disciplined, and provided an audience or, you know, a market or whatever, then, of course, it can thrive, it can flourish, and it can do what the gift was meant to do. Otherwise, you know, Charlie Parker might wind up thinking he's a crack dealer in these days and time because his gift is not appreciated. He's not even recognized because they took music out of the school.
It was just the kind of thing that was so right on time. After all the love changes, my heart had locked the door. Then that girl released her magic and made me love once more. Shining down on me, oh, all at once turned my life around, and with one kiss she set me free. She's given me joy, joy, joy. That girl, she brings me joy. She's given me joy, joy, joy. So long to my heartache. Now that joy has taken over and decided to stay. Her love lifts me up like no other love before. With every beat of my heart, I'm holding on, oh, hey, just look what she's done for me. She's erased all the sadness away, oh, I can never repay the deed, 'cause she keeps loving me more and more. She's given me joy, joy, joy.
In the world that I would do for you. Check one, check two. I can't hold back. I'm in love with you. Check one, check two. It's nothing in the world
that girl, she's giving me joy, joy. I love the way she loves me. She brings me joy. She's giving me joy, joy, joy.
Said I love it, baby. Oh, girl,
I love the joy she brings me. She brings me joy. She brings me joy.
In the world that all I wouldn't do for you. Check one, check two. I can't hold back. I'm in
all
love
my
with you. Check one, check two. I can't hold back.
Girl,
I'm in love,
you're
with
my joy.
Thank you. This presentation of Remembering Martin is brought to you by Some Families, a society of multi-ethnic families. Some Families is a group dedicated to fostering the positive self-awareness of all children, particularly those of multi-ethnic or interracial backgrounds. The 13 performers are elementary students from the John F. Kennedy School in Zehlendorf, Berlin. Our narrator is Ty Thomas, a student of music and a graduate of the John F. Kennedy School. In a day when young people are hungry for honest heroes, we would like to remember a man whose life truly did make a difference. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. believed that the dignity we strive for is dreamed of and indeed destined for every man, woman, and child. He wanted us all to be able to soar and believed that, yes, we too can fly.
The year was 1930. In the city of Berlin, Germany, a young African-American contralto made her European concert debut to overwhelming critical success. Marian Anderson's was a voice you were privileged to hear once in 100 years. She was the first black woman to sing solo at the Metropolitan Opera, and she was a friend of Martin Luther King Jr.
He's got the whole world in his hands. 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 Dr. King used to love to hear me sing that song for him. He also said I had God's special gift. But you, all of you, must believe that everyone has a gift for something, even if it is the gift of just being a good friend.
Another friend of Dr. King was Rosa Parks, who has been called the mother of the civil rights movement. She was arrested on a bus in Montgomery, Alabama, when she refused to give up her seat to a white man. The year was 1955, and her decision catapulted the young Reverend King into the curious and watchful eyes of the entire world. Yes, Rosa Parks was tired.
Yes, I was tired. But only tired of always giving in. That's what I told Reverend King. There'll be many times in your life when you will have to make a decision and you will be alone. That's what I learned back on the bus of Montgomery.
She continues to this day at age 84 to encourage young people to read books rather than watch TV, always ask a lot of questions, and fight racism and discrimination. She says, it's the right thing to do. By traveling to India, he studied and discovered firsthand the teachings of Mahatma Gandhi, which led Dr. King to take a more peaceful, nonviolent approach to solving the great civil rights problems in America.
I would have been proud of him, like a father to a son, when he won the Nobel Peace Prize in 1964.
As president, John F. Kennedy knew that change was coming, and he recognized that Martin Luther King Jr., with his sense of courage and conviction, was at the front of this great wave sweeping the country.
In 1960, I said to my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. Then I met with Dr. King. I heard his voice, I looked into his eyes, and I knew he was the kind of American I was talking about. He knew we were in this together, and he believed in us all.
As one of the first black women to reach international stardom, Josephine Baker was a singer, a dancer, and even had a short career as a French spy. Her 12, yes, 12 adopted children from many backgrounds were lovingly referred to as her Rainbow Tribe.
When I performed, I always worked for the rights of my people. I'll tell you this though, I was there back in 1963 when I heard him say, "I have a dream," and I knew our time was coming. We were entering a future I had always hoped for.
At the same time, Malcolm X, a leader of the black Muslim movement in America, was also trying to effect change and influence the future of black America. He, like King, would meet a tragic and violent death.
Sure, brother. You can say, Minister King and I took different roads, but we both ended at the same final stop, didn't we? You might try to say something wrong like, our goals were different, but freedom now and for the future was the end we both wanted. And now you tell me, friend, are we there yet? Are we there yet?
One of the most uplifting scenes in recent memory was the release after 27 years from a South African prison of Nelson Mandela. Born to be the leader of this African nation, he continues today to be a symbol of freedom and hope for the future.
Freedom! Africa! Free! These are the words my heart has been singing since a long, long time. Not just for me or for my South Africa, but for all. For all.
The spirit of Dr. King lives on in Mandela's words. It also is evident in the life of Olympic champion Jackie Joyner Kersee. Considered by many to be the greatest woman athlete, she works today to inspire young people around the world to always keep trying, even in the face of difficulties.
As Dr. King always said, let nothing stand in your way. I didn't even let asthma stand in my way. I always had something to shoot for each year, to jump one inch further.
Basketball great Isaiah Thomas has similar words for people young and old on how to never give up through your struggles. He said,
I have always believed, no matter how many shots I miss, I'm always going to make the next one.
Many of us were witnesses to what seems to be the instant stardom of 21-year-old golfer Tiger Woods. Now, more than ever, the doors that Martin Luther King was knocking on are opening up wider and wider.
I am the youngest golfer ever to win a master tournament, but I will always be thankful to those who came before me to help make golf a game where all people can be included.
There is an African proverb that says, if we stand tall, it is because we stand on the backs of those who came before us. One person who stands tall and proud today is the Reverend Jesse Jackson. He has been a leader for the rights and privileges of common and uncommon people all of his life. He learned from and worked personally with Dr. King and was with him just before his death on April 4th, 1968, in Memphis, Tennessee.
Dr. King taught us well through his life and death how to live with courage and conviction. Even to this day and beyond, let us keep his hope alive. Keep hope alive. Keep hope alive. Keep hope alive. Keep hope alive.
The great African-American poet Maya Angelou spoke from her heart when she wrote these words.
When I think on Martin King, shattered youth of days gone by, Lord, we all were different then. Who can say we aren't changed and renewed once again because of him? Let us achieve a future meant to be.
Reverend King's widow, Coretta Scott King, along with her four children, continues today her husband's hopes for civil rights for oppressed peoples throughout America and the world. In keeping his spirit alive for now and future generations, she said it simply and best for us.
He did not belong to us. He belonged to the whole world.
He belonged to the entire world. Dr. King said about himself, he was not just an American citizen, but a citizen of the whole world. For that world he lived, for that world he died, and for the future of that world, we remember him still.
But not only that, let freedom ring from Stone Mountain of Georgia. Let freedom ring from Lookout Mountain of Tennessee. Let freedom ring from every hill and molehill of Mississippi, from every mountainside. Let freedom ring when we gather. When we allow freedom ring, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all of us, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last, thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
Minus eins und München, minus ein Grad. Wetter und Nachrichten wieder hier bei Jam FM in einer Stunde. Yes, we are back in time now. 4 minutes past the hour of 5 o'clock. And what you just heard for the first hour was a super remix from Inspector G. And now getting back to the program with some music from Yvette Michelle, Puff Daddy, Arrested Development. The remix from Keith Sweat, Mary J. Blige, and Lost Boys Get Up. Mix, Mad Blackstreet, Missy Elliott, and of course lots, lots more. So keep it tuned in to the station that plays always the finest in black music, Jam FM Night Groove Special. Of course, at 8 o'clock tonight, Stephen Earle brings you the finest in blue notes, the jazz scene, right here at Jam FM. The Mary J. Blige old school flavor reminisce. And now let's take it one step higher. At 39 minutes past the hour, 5 o'clock. The Lost Boys want you to come on, get busy, and get on up with Night Groove Special. Up until 8 o'clock, rocking your world, giving you the finest in black music only here at Jam FM.
And welcome to our State of Affairs portion of the program with our usual panelists, Dr. Temba Kadali, and Mr. Charles Achie Odong, and with our special guest, Inspector Gadget, also known as Herman Purcell. Welcome to the Collegium.
Thank you.
Could you please tell us a little bit about the background, Herman, your education, and where does the name Inspector Gadget come from?
Well, to begin with, from my background, born and raised in Reedsville, North Carolina, mm-hmm. attended Brentworth High School, graduated, then came into the Army. As a soldier for 8 years, and around about 1983, I came into really began to get into the club scene. I worked with a guy by the name of Master Blaster, and he needed help, so he asked me to join his team. The name Inspector Gadget, well, that's a different story. In 1985, I decided to go home on vacation and to seek new music. And I happened to go back to my hometown and went to this record store, and there it is, the song from the cartoon crew, Inspector Gadget. Mm-hmm. So I'm thinking to myself, well, it's exciting to have a different name than everybody else. Besides, it kind of like catches your ear a little bit to make you think, what is it or who is it? And since then, it's been running pretty strong.
How did you arrive in Germany, and what has been your current activities?
I arrived in Germany in 1981 on orders upon the United States Army, based here in Berlin, Germany. From 1981 until 1984, and I ended my term of service, 1984, worked for the Army Hospital. Mm-hmm. Therefore, after that, became more and more involved in music, as far because the first things that we did do was like we had the Army clubs here that working also as a soldier. So it kind of like worked hand in hand. Shortly thereafter, when the Army finally decided to leave upon the wall coming down, I worked in various discotheques and they helped build different clubs because the atmosphere was low or the public was low, so I stepped more towards that branch.
Could you tell us something about your current profession?
My current profession now is a DJ. I'm currently working at Jam FM radio station here in Berlin.
Okay.
This requires radio moderation and, of course, DJ activities live in various clubs. I've been there now for the last 2 years at various clubs all over West Germany because the Jam FM station, we are only on cable at the time being, and it's bundesweit all over Germany. Therefore, everyone has a chance to get involved with the music, with the club scene, also to hear different aspects of the music while it's being produced out new.
I see.
Inspector, could you please give us a little bit of an overview of the music that you play, the history of some of the music?
Okay, to go back to the history, if you already realized that long time ago, during the slavery times, it was forbidden to sing, it was forbidden to worship, it was forbidden to gather as a congregation. Mm-hmm. Music started then, in my opinion, because this is the way that they could express themselves. To forget about the trouble, as some of the songs that were sung, no one knows the troubles I see, or carrying this load on my heavy back. And it's more or less that the music was provided for them from themselves, to forget about those times, to ease the burdens, to ease the pains, and also to make the work a little bit easier. It's the same thing as of today. If you have a hard job to do, and you know that it has to be done, you don't really think about it. You know that it has to be done, so you think about something else. This is my opinion, as that the slaves did. They thought about the good times that were going on because they were in bondage. They could not get away. So they sung songs and hymns of praise to themselves. Therefore, relieving all the tension and all of the anxieties that they had from the masters. Which goes today too. If you are in various clubs as much as I am to participate in what is really going on, that you will see people act different towards different types of music. And this aspect that really I'm talking about now, black music, there are so many different kinds of black music, R&B, dance floor, hip hop, gangster rap, soul and funk. It has different aspects and people react different to that when they hear different kinds of music. If the music is very hard, then you see an aggressive energy come up from people. If it's soft music, then people are more relaxed, they're more laid back, and this tension is not there.
What you've just been explaining is quite interesting. The question is there special training for this kind of profession?
That's a good question. I would say special training, anyone just can't be a DJ. First of all, you have to know the music. Also feel the music. I wasn't trained. I grew up in the church as a kid, sang in the choir. Later on, we formed a quartet group, and I've always been musically inclined. Therefore, as to be a DJ in a club, you have to know the beats. So if you want to keep the crowd interested in the music, keep the crowd there in the club, there's nonstop music. On the other hand, as a radio DJ, there is no nonstop music. You're on the air, you're providing a service for the listeners. You're also doing commercials, you're also doing weather, you're also doing news. Right. You're doing a various majority of things that keep people interested in your radio station, that builds you up more and more. Training, I would say, as per a radio station, there is training that is required. I got kind of lucky, as you might say, and got into the station just on time. We do have trainers there that train us to speak correctly, to handle our voice correctly in German and in English. But that's, like I say, as far as a club DJ, you really have to be on your toes and be trained for that, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
What is the influence of the music you play on the audience? Is there a constructive purpose of the music? And if yes, could you describe what purpose that is?
Constructive, good example is, as I said before, there are different types of black music, rap, hip hop, gangster funk, and funk music. Most people react to the meaning of the music, to the words of the music. Therefore, they build what they hear upon what they want to be, or either their expressions. They see themselves actually performing the song themselves. Being constructive is in another way is also concerning that when people hear other kind of music besides the hardcore music, they also feel that this music is building them up towards another level where they can relax. The atmosphere is nice. There's no anxiety. There's no aggression. And there's more or less a smooth type of music which really soothes the savage beast in mankind.
What are your plans for the future? Which way is up?
Straight up, straight to the top. My plans are to continue in the music branch. Next year, I want to study engineering, sound engineering, studio and for TV and for radio. Mm-hmm. Also, maybe in the near future, open up a cafe or something. But I want to stay basically attached to the music scene because it's my life.
Great. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Stay with us. We will now go to our arts calendar. And remember, you are participating in The Collegium. Thank you.
wonder if she could tell I'm hard right now. Yeah, come on, dance for me, baby. Yeah. Uh-oh, you feel that? All right. Come on, don't stop now. You done did it. Come on, yeah. All right. Hold up.
Almost like we're sexing.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, boo, I like it. No, I can't deny it. But I know you can tell I'm excited.